Hello, I'm Matt Galloway, and this is The Current Podcast.
We are gearing up for a rocky parliamentary session here in Ottawa. Jagmeet Singh has ripped up his agreement with the Liberals. Pierre Poilievre is chomping at the bit to get a motion of non-confidence going. And there are questions about just how long the Liberal government and Justin Trudeau as the party's leader can survive. Joining me to break it all down is our team of political watchers. Stephanie Levitz is a senior reporter for the Globe and Mail's Ottawa Bureau. Ryan Tumilty is a parliamentary reporter for the National Post. And Rosie Barton is the CBC's chief political correspondent. Good morning to you all.
Good morning.
Morning.
Good morning.
I use that word rocky. What word would you describe the parliamentary session ahead? Rosie, let's start with you.
Unpredictable, which is something that journalists like us like. Right. So that'll be exciting. I think that there is some unpredictability to it, some potential for instability. But I think that the likelihood that we get to a place where an election happens this fall is pretty slim. And that's because most opposition parties don't want that to happen, neither the NDP nor from what we can hear from the Bloc Québécois, them either. So you just have the Conservatives sort of sitting there, as you said, chomping at the bit and hoping to make this happen. So they will try to do that through a confidence motion. They will try to put pressure on their friends to join them in this venture. But I think it's still going to be kind of exciting because the whole dynamic inside the House has changed. And while there's no formal deal, the government is now going to have to find ways to ensure its own survival. That's how minority parliaments work, but that will mean that we can take nothing for granted.
Rosie had lots more than one word. Ryan, what's your one word?
I thought that was just a turn of phrase.
Frenetic. It would be my one word. I think, you know, I agree with Rosie that I don't think we will see a fall campaign. It's just not in enough people's interests. But that doesn't mean that we won't see chaos in the House. The one thing about the supply and confidence agreement, I think, that's sort of underappreciated is that it also made other legislation move through the House quicker and easier. There were less, you know, marathon debates, for example. There was sort of more agreement on doing things in a bit more of an orderly fashion. And the NDP helped the Liberals move bills along, even if they weren't part of the confidence agreement. So all of that's out the window, probably.
Stephanie, I should have known better than to try to hold those two to one word. You go with your one word.
And I'll pick sort of a combination of where the two of them landed, which is kinetic.
Okay.
Everything is going to be in moving. It's always going to be constant motion, this parliament. Nothing is probably going to get done because everything is going to be about jockeying for political supremacy, for attacking the other person, for making it everybody's life difficult. It's going to be in constant motion, but nothing's actually going to get created.
Okay. Let's get into this. Pierre Poilievre has been daring the NDP to join the Conservatives in a non-confidence vote. Let's hear him.
Common sense Conservatives will put forward a non-confidence motion at the earliest possible opportunity. And I'm asking Jagmeet Singh and the NDP to commit unequivocally before Monday's by-elections. Will they vote non-confidence to bring down the costly coalition and trigger a carbon tax election? Or will Jagmeet Singh sell out Canadians again?
Okay, so listening to you guys, you don't think that it's going to happen this fall. But Stephanie Levitz, how likely is Pierre Poilievre to get the votes out to bring the government down?
Oh, that's a great question. I mean, a lot of it will depend on the context of it all. At what point in time is he actually able to table what would be a binding non-confidence motion in the government? I mean, that is somewhat up to the government itself. The way the parliamentary calendar works, they have to schedule certain days for the opposition to have its business. That could not, in theory, that could be months from now, not days from now. And as we have seen consistently in the life of, you know, this parliament, things change from week to week so quickly that the conditions to bring down the government that may or may not exist, let's say next week, could be entirely different in 2 months' time.
Okay, Ryan, you mentioned the supply and confidence agreement. Jagmeet Singh metaphorically ripped it up anyway, and he's been trying to distance himself from the Liberals. Even yesterday, he suggested the NDP is against the carbon tax.
We want to see an approach to fighting the climate crisis where it doesn't put the burden on the backs of working people, where big polluters have to pay their fair share. They have to pay the price of their pollution, but it shouldn't be on working people's shoulders. And so we've been working on a plan, and we'll be releasing our plan, our vision for how we can do that in a stronger way in the coming months.
So, Ryan, pretty light on details there. Wouldn't say exactly where he stood on the price of carbon for consumers. What should we read into that?
I think what I read into that is that he is trying to distance himself from the Liberals and from one of their more unpopular policies. The carbon tax, you know, is at best begrudgingly accepted. It is not a popular policy. It has never been a popular policy. But the Liberals feel that it is a necessary policy to deal with climate change. The NDP feel that climate change has to be dealt with, of course. And they've supported this tax in the past. So I found those comments interesting yesterday. And I guess we'll wait and see what more details looks like when the NDP leader gets around to creating them.
It hasn't been a popular tax, but it does seem like there's a bit of a pile-on going on right now. Rosie, BC has an election coming up next month. NDP leader David Eby said yesterday if they're reelected, his party would end the provincial carbon tax if the federal government dropped the legal requirement for it. And that's significant. I mean, BC was first in jurisdiction in North America to have a carbon tax. So how big of a problem for this is for the federal Liberals?
Yeah, I mean, that BC has had a consensus around the need to price carbon before almost anyone else. Quebec would be closely behind. So the idea now that this is suddenly not on the table is significant. I mean, as you say, there is an election happening. And the other party also promised to get rid of the carbon tax if the federal government, this federal government, is not reelected. So there's a lot of politics going on there. But I do think it feeds into what Pierre Poilievre has been saying for months now, that he wants a carbon tax election, that this is a real vulnerability for the Liberal government, that they themselves admit they have failed to properly explain it to Canadians. And if we now have sort of momentum building against a carbon tax, I think that that is potentially very troubling for Justin Trudeau. I will say, though, I felt like Jagmeet Singh painted himself into yet another corner by saying that yesterday. I get why he did it. I think Brian's right to distinguish himself. But now he has to also take that into consideration every time he votes. It's like every time he takes a position or criticizes something, he puts himself into a space where he's going to have to be able to justify why he's voting for or against.
Yeah. So what does he do? I mean, Stephanie, let me ask you. I mean, do we have any clues from the NDP about what they'd be likely to support and where those lines might be?
We can look to the past, I suppose, for some degree of an example, and something that Jagmeet Singh and his party has said a lot, that they try to focus on what delivers benefits to Canadians. So perhaps, you know, we find ourselves in a situation where if we're talking, for example, the third reading vote on a piece of legislation that the NDP has been championing, such as pharmacare, you know, okay, they're going to vote for that, but they're not going to vote for other things. It doesn't really matter until we get to a confidence motion, though, right? So if some of that then will come down to how the Conservatives intend to frame the language that they'll use, right? Will they go, sometimes the Conservatives love to load things up with a ton of political preamble, you know, whereas the blah, 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 and the carbon tax, da, and da, 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 and they make everybody vote on it. And it's a lot of, you know, song and dance there. If the Conservative, and then that will force Jagmeet Singh into a corner because he's going to have to justify. If the Conservatives just go clean and clear, the House has lost confidence in the government. Maybe that's something that Jagmeet Singh can, in fact, vote for, because if he doesn't, then how does he justify anything anymore at all?
Let's talk about specifics. I mean, the one thing that Jagmeet Singh said, that part of what soured his party on its deal with the Liberals, was the decision to send the railway workers to binding arbitration. Ryan, there's pressure on the government now to intervene in yet another labor dispute, this time with Air Canada pilots. What's your sense on what the government is weighing with those options?
You know, I think it's the same thing that the government has to weigh every time it comes up with these options, and that is, you know, what is the broader impact of a strike like that? The rail strike was going to be catastrophic to this country if it extended for, you know, more than a few days. $1 billion in freight moves on those lines every day. You know, you were talking about things like grain farmers, you know, losing $50 million a day. You were talking about cities facing problems getting chlorine for their water treatment plants. Like, those sorts of things become essential. I don't think the Liberals were particularly eager to be dragged into that dispute. I don't think they're particularly eager to be dragged into the Air Canada dispute either. I think Air Canada will be different for the government because it is not as significant as the two national rail lines. But certainly it's another pressure point, and it is kind of illustrating the difference between being in opposition and being in government. In government, sometimes you have to take politically unpopular choices for the greater good, and, you know, this might be one of them.
Rosie, let me get your take on that, because a lot of listeners looking at their plane tickets nervously right now. What are the politics at play there?
Yeah, I totally agree that this is one of those moments where you maybe don't want to be the government and have to make hard decisions. Steve McKinnon, the Labour minister, is in Toronto talking to both sides, telling them to stay at the table. You heard the Prime Minister say the same thing yesterday. But as that's being said, you know, Jagmeet Singh says absolutely no binding arbitration. And even Pierre Poilievre kind of stayed away from that, only saying that pilots aren't paid enough in this country. I agree that it's not as catastrophic as the rail stoppage, but I think it affects Canadians like more directly in some ways. You know, if there's 100,000 Canadians traveling on Air Canada every day, hundreds of flights, and people stuck sort of mid-holiday, and they are maybe not going to take their anger out just on Air Canada. They could potentially take it out on a government that doesn't seek to move quickly. So I fear that that's probably where things are headed if these two sides can't get a deal.
And of course, we've got by-elections. Let's talk by-elections. We started the summer with that big shocker in the riding of Toronto-St. Paul's, which was a solid Liberal seat, now Conservative. Stephanie, we're starting the fall with another two by-elections on Monday, one in Winnipeg, one in Montreal. Could we see another political earthquake?
Yeah, it's interesting. I mean, different stakes, really, for both ridings. In the Toronto by-election, it was a clean Conservative versus Liberal fight. In the other two, the two by-elections we have coming up on Monday, the one in Quebec near Montreal is a three-way fight, really. It's Liberals, New Democrats, the Bloc Québécois. The Conservatives are non-existent in this particular campaign. Who ends up winning it in LaSalle will be interesting, because it will be either a boost or a demoralizing moment for either side. So if the Liberals lose it, many people think they will. You know, is this another sort of notch in the line of things that will lead people to say Justin Trudeau must go? If the New Democrats win it, they can claim victory and say, look, see, we told you ripping up the deal was a great idea. Look what it's done for us, even though it might not actually be connected. If the Bloc Québécois win, you know, this bolsters this idea. We sometimes forget about the Bloc in our national political discussions, but they do have a lot of power in the House of Commons and in Parliament. A pickup in this seat against the Liberal government would put some wind in their sails, and it would be interesting to see what sort of they try to extract from the Liberal government in exchange for propping them up, which they could very well do.
I also want to ask you guys about the Liberal staffing issues right now. The National Campaign Director announced he's quitting this week. It seems two cabinet ministers, Pablo Rodriguez, Marie-Claude Bibeau, are considering seeking different elected offices rather than running for re-election. So, Ryan, let's listen to Justin Trudeau first. He keeps getting asked about his political future. Let's listen to his answer.
I can't wait to continue getting into it this fall with Poilievre, whose perspective is cuts are the only way forward, because I know that confident countries invest in their future, invest in their workers, invest in their people, and that's what we're going to continue to do.
Ryan, Justin Trudeau can't wait. What do we think of that answer?
You know, I think that's a genuine answer, actually. I do think that the Prime Minister likes sparring with Pierre Poilievre. I think the two of them are, you know, I think they're more than just parliamentary opponents. I think they fundamentally don't like each other. You know, I don't see the Prime Minister inviting Pierre Poilievre around to Rideau Cottage for a drink at any point in time. That's just not the relationship. And I do think that, you know, the Liberals definitely feel that they have a alternative vision of the country, that Pierre Poilievre is running against that vision fundamentally. And they really do believe that, you know, in a better economy, when Canadians start to feel better, when interest rates start to come down and people start comparing the two alternatives you know, that the Liberal Party will be able to pull ahead.
Justin Trudeau seems to be sticking to his line. We all know from Joe Biden now that, that leaders are absolutely staying on until they aren't. Rosie, are there any chances of Justin Trudeau being out before this election?
I mean, sure. I'm not going to be the person that's going to say it's impossible. But I think that he is, as Ryan said, quite excited to take on a fight against Pierre Poilievre. Then I will say that after their caucus meeting earlier this week in British Columbia, many of the people I reached out to, caucus members, feel a little bit better about things, frankly. There was a presentation made by his chief of staff and his executive director of communications to talk about sort of what they were going to talk about through the fall and what direction they were headed. And some MPs found that quite reassuring. I think for the MPs who don't find that reassuring, who are concerned about their jobs, who are going to be watching what happens on Monday, those by-elections, there's a possibility that some of those people just start leaving. You mentioned two cabinet ministers, but there are other people. Andy Fillmore has left his seat to run to be the mayor of Halifax. And other people might make those kinds of decisions as well. Because if you know the leader's not going anywhere, nobody's trying to get rid of him actively, your only other option then is to show yourself the door.
Stephanie, I want to get your take too, though. I mean, should Liberals be looking to the South at what happened with the Democrats and wondering if their leader should be stepping aside?
I think there's probably a pretty big distinction between Joe Biden and Justin Trudeau. And one of those distinctions is about 35 years of age. Right. The energy level that President Joe Biden was putting forward to American voters, sort of the physical stumbles, some of that, that was the thing perhaps that was really turning people off. I would say that even conservatives will agree that Justin Trudeau remains a formidable campaigner. He's charismatic. The polls are what they are, but people do still like him. They do still respond to him. There is life in the old dog yet, you know, and while it would be the conservatives would certainly be thrown into a strategic problem if Justin Trudeau were to leave, because really they're framing everything right now around Justin Trudeau. Everything is Justin Trudeau's fault. And so if he were to go, it would be interesting to see how they would pivot. But I think, you know, there is, I'm sure, some liberals looking down to the South and saying, well, hey, like, look what happened, you know, reverse their fortunes. The Democrats were moribund. But I don't think that the stakes or the situation plays out identically here in Canada.
We've got about 30 seconds left. I just got to ask about a wild rumor floating around. Mark Carney, is that a possibility for a leader? Ryan, last word to you.
I don't think it's a possibility for a leader unless Justin Trudeau decides he wants to leave. Mark Carney, I think it's a pretty much open secret, has an interest in future politics, an interest in leadership politics one day. But he's not pushing Justin Trudeau out the door. That's not why he decided to go work for him at the Liberal Party, basically.
All right. Canadians should be looking forward to an unexpected, a kinetic fall, apparently, frantic and chaotic. I'm sure we'll have to have you back on the panel. Thank you all for joining us.
Thanks, Duncan.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Stephanie Levitz is a senior reporter for the Globe and Mail's Ottawa Bureau. Ryan Tumilty is a parliamentary reporter for the National Post. And Rosie Barton is the CBC's chief political correspondent.